Before we begin this video, be sure to like, share and subscribe and ding the little notification bell, since less than 5% of my viewer base is actually subscribed, so if you did subscribe, it would mean a hell of a lot to me. Thank you very much, and let's get started with the video. When I'm dreaming up new All the Inaccuracies episodes, most of the ideas for them come from viewer suggestions. An example being the latest episode on The Ballad of Magellan and The Sound of Stalin. As a result, I have a rather long list of things that have been suggested to me that I haven't actually made an episode out of yet. This includes things like Bill Wirtz's History of the Entire World, I guess, several Schoolhouse Rock episodes, and the intro to Phineas and Ferb. That last one is one that actually took my interest in particular, since I figured that there was a lot of scope for inaccuracies in it. But after some close examination, I only found three. Well, four, because I found another one after the fact, but still, that doesn't exactly make for a full-length All the Inaccuracies episode. However, looking at the intro's format did give me another idea. Namely, how long exactly would it take to do all the things stated in this intro, and could Phineas and Ferb realistically do all these things within their 104-day summer vacation? So for the sake of doing something other than All the Inaccuracies, but which might still pull viewers, I'm gonna do the maths on this. Spoilers, the answer to the second question is a resounding no. Now admittedly, this is an idea which has its limits, namely that there are several things stated in the intro that I'm not gonna be able to quantify outside of the context of the show, because they're not feasible or possible even in theory. In these cases, what I'll be doing is trying to find an episode of the show in which the event in question actually did happen, to try and estimate the time frame from that. Despite my best efforts though, some things did elude my analysis, namely the things currently on screen. These are things which I couldn't quantify even in the context of the show for various reasons, shown on screen now. Another limit is that I'm neither a scientist nor a mathematician, so this investigation probably isn't going to be anywhere near perfect. Feel free to drop a comment if you think I've done something wrong somewhere. So without any further padding for time, let's launch into the first thing, which is building a rocket. This first activity is a pretty simple calculation. According to NASA, it took nearly 2 years and 2 months to build the Space Shuttle Enterprise, so presuming that Phineas and Ferb have the Fireside girls helping them out, we'll presume that they're taking that long themselves. Great going! Not one activity in and we're already over our 104-day time budget by just under 2 years. Nevertheless, moving on. Fighting a mummy. The ability to actually reanimate a mummy notwithstanding, the first thing to consider here is, where exactly is a mummy to be found? In the show itself, Phineas and Ferb attempt to find a mummy in a movie theatre come museum, but don't actually find one, instead finding some fakey promotional junk and candies wrapped in some bandages with a mouthful of stale gum, so we'll have to assume that in order to find a mummy, they'll have to go to the source. Egypt. Now, a brief aside, trying to locate Danville is about as productive as trying to locate Springfield, to the point that one could probably dedicate an entire video to it. So I took a random location in America, namely somewhere in North Carolina, and worked out how long it'd take to get from there to Cairo International by air. I came up with a flight time of about 12 hours and 45 minutes from our Danville to Cairo International Airport, according to travelmath.com. Now, whenever we discuss passenger flights in this video, we'll be adding 2 to 2.5 hours onto the time to account for wait times and airport delays and such. So I rounded this flight time up to a round but sensible 15 hours. After that, they need to get from Cairo to the nearest pyramid, and what better place than the Giza Necropolis? From Cairo Airport to the Necropolis, it's about 32 minutes by taxi, according to Rome to Rio. And once they're there, well, it being the case that we can't actually resurrect mummies and the time it takes to find one isn't something we can really measure, we'll just presume that the entire process of finding a mummy and getting out of that pyramid after the fact takes about 1 hour, and I presume Phineas and Ferb have prepared for that anyway. After that, it must be asked, how long does it actually take to fight the mummy? Well, again, we can't say for certain, since mummies can't actually be resurrected, and as before stated, the show doesn't actually contain a fight with a real mummy, so let's use another film that does instead. Namely, 2001's The Mummy Returns. Main character Rick and Imhotep, the titular mummy, become engaged in a battle near the end of the film. Using freely available clips of the movie from YouTube, I calculated that this fight lasts all in all about 4 minutes and 39 seconds, presuming that they are still fighting off-screen when other stuff is being shown. Then, of course, we have to double our previous travel time to account for Phineas and Ferb getting back to Danville, meaning our final calculation for this element is 15 hours times 2 plus 32 minutes times 2, plus 4 minutes 39 seconds plus 1 hour. Which gives us a grand total of 1 day, 8 hours, 8 minutes, 39 seconds to locate and fight a mummy. Next, climbing up the Eiffel Tower. First, again, Phineas and Ferb have to get from Danville to Paris, where the Eiffel Tower is. According to travelmath.com, it would take just under 9 hours, or 8 hours 42 minutes, to get from our presumed location of Danville from earlier to Paris-Charles de Gaulle Airport. We'll round that up to 11 hours, and according to Rome to Rio, from Paris-Charles de Gaulle Airport, it's 31 minutes by taxi to the Eiffel Tower. Let's round that up to 40 minutes to account for waiting times and traffic and such. Now, how long would it take to climb up the Eiffel Tower? Outside Online claims that it once took one man about 7 hours to scale from the second balcony of the Eiffel Tower to the third one. That's a distance of approximately 528 feet, and the tower as a whole is about 1,063 feet, which is just over double that. So since we're working with approximations anyway, we'll just double the 7 hours to get a grand total time of 14 hours for climbing up the Eiffel Tower. And since the intro only specifies climbing up the Eiffel Tower, we won't double that again, we'll just presume they take the lift down. And then presuming that the travel time back is the same as the travel time there, we'll just double our travel time from earlier. The calculation for this one is thus 11 hours 40 minutes times 2 plus 14 hours. Meaning that in total, to get from Danville to Paris, climb the Eiffel Tower and get back again would take approximately 1 day 13 hours 20 minutes. Next up, discovering something that doesn't exist. As those of you who already saw the very short inaccuracies video I made on this will know already, this is impossible because the statement self-negates. If it doesn't exist, it can't be discovered. However, this did actually happen in the context of the show. So I handed over to my friend Tom, who has a degree in electrical engineering and is a massive Phineas and Ferb fan. And through a combination of applied mathematics and Phineas and Ferb nerdery, he managed to decipher this. In the episode Fireside Girl Jamboree, Phineas and Ferb discover the something that doesn't exist from the intro, namely the turtle unicorn, and from various cues in the animation, he determined that it took them between 13 minutes 12 seconds and 14 minutes 18 seconds to do this. So for our timing for this activity, we'll use the longer of those times. Giving a monkey a shower. Well, this one is relatively simple too. All we have to do is take the amount of time it usually takes for a human to have a shower and round it to the nearest 10 to account for the manhandling of the monkey. According to a survey performed by Unilever in 2011, the average person showers for about 8 minutes. So if we round that up to 10 minutes, that gives us our time for giving a monkey a shower. After that, there's a rash of 4 incalculable ones, so let's move right on to painting a continent. Again, this is something we will have to partially turn to the episode itself for, since I doubt you could actually paint an entire continent in real life. In the intro, my Discord server and I managed to work out that Phineas and Ferb's helicopter, with which they are doing the painting, travels at about 50 meters per second, and that their roller is, at an estimate, about 66 meters wide. This means that every second, Phineas and Ferb can paint an area of roughly 50 by 70 meters every second, meaning that they're painting 3,500 square meters per second, 210,000 per minute, and 12,600,000 meters, or roughly 12.6 square kilometers per hour. I'm presuming that they'll paint the nearest continent to hand, namely North America, the total land area of which is about 18,665,933 kilometers squared, which we will round up to 20 million to account for the fact they'll be flying over a fair bit of ocean and considering they'll have to stop to refuel and reload the roller and such. And since time equals speed over distance, our answer is 20 million square kilometers divided by 12.6 square kilometers per hour. This gives us our answer of Phineas and Ferb being able to paint the entire North American continent in approximately 181 years, 2 months, 11 days, 18 hours, 16 minutes, 9 seconds. To put that into perspective, that alone is just over 2.3 times the average life expectancy in America and nearly 636 104-day summer vacations in itself. Next up, driving your sister insane. Now, there are ways in which I can calculate this in terms of actual insanity, but in the interest of keeping this video relatively lighthearted, we'll instead limit ourselves to the context of the show. Since by driving their sister insane, Phineas and Ferb just seem to mean pissing Candace off. Now, Phineas and Ferb spent more or less their entire summer vacation driving Candace insane, sometimes intentionally, sometimes not, so for this one, let's just use the length of the show in total. There's no way of quantifying exactly how much time each episode takes up of real time, so I'm going off episode lengths here. And hey, what better way to drive Candace insane than to marathon the very series in which she appears? Now, there are 133 episodes of the show made up of 222 segments total, but in 12 of those segments, Candace either doesn't appear or only appears for less than a minute, one of these being a 22-minute full episode segment. Meaning we have to lop off about 143 minutes from the total time since they aren't relevant to our investigation. There are also two movies, which are 78 minutes and 85 minutes long respectively. Candace also appears in a crossover episode with Milo Murphy's Law, which clocks in at about 47 minutes. So adding the total runtime of the entire show, plus the movies, plus the Milo Murphy's Law crossover, minus the total length of the episode segments in which Candace didn't appear or not for longer than a minute, makes for a grand total of 2 days, 1 hour and 53 minutes that Phineas and Ferb have spent in total driving their sister insane. And that's that. Or is it? Because you see, there is a second verse to the intro, as seen on the soundtrack album and in the episode Phineas and Ferb's Quantum Boogaloo. This means we have to quantify those as well. And I'll start with Crossing the Tundra. Ooh, this is the most complicated of the lot. Presuming that by the tundra is meant Antarctica, first Phineas and Ferb need to actually reach it. Flights to the Antarctic leave from the very tip of Chile, the closest airport to which is Presidente Carlos Ibáñez del Campo International Airport in Punta Arenas. So Phineas and Ferb's first trip is from Danville to Punta Arenas. Now here I must admit I made a scientific error. Namely, I forgot where my presumed location of Danville is and didn't make a note of it. So from here on out, my point of reference will instead be a real place called Danville, namely East Danville in Ohio. Now, Rome to Rio's times tend to fluctuate, but it usually comes to about 24 hours and about 30 to 40 something minutes to get from East Danville to Punta Arenas, so we'll round the time shown on there to about 1 day and 3 hours to account for airport wait times. From there to Antarctica then takes a further 7 days and 12 hours, which again we'll add 2 hours to, meaning the first leg of their journey takes about 8 days and 17 hours. But that's just getting there, now they have to actually cross the tundra. But how? Well, according to Institut Polaire.fr, Antarctica is approximately 5,500 kilometers across. The intro shows that they're using some kind of wind foil to cross it, so presuming that the wind is favourable, the average cruising speed for a wind foil is somewhere in the region of 20 knots. So just to make our maths easier, if they maintain a constant average speed of just above that at 21.6 knots, that translates to about 40 kilometers per hour. And if we use the before stated formula to solve for time, to travel 5,500 kilometers at 40 kilometers per hour would take approximately 137 hours 30 minutes. Or in more manageable terms, 5 days 17 hours 30 minutes. And we'll round that up to 6 days, since they'll probably need to take short breaks and swap over every so often. Now I kind of eyeballed it, and from where they landed on Antarctica, I reckon that Phineas and Ferb would end up at these coordinates here. Now, the nearest base to them that has aeroplanes is Vostok Station, which is about 2 days away from their coordinates if they used the same wind foil and went at the same speeds. Now, Rome to Rio doesn't exactly calculate flights from Vostok Station back to Punta Arenas because they're not really passenger flights, so I had to calculate this one by myself. Since Vostok Station is Russian-owned, the planes are likely to be IL-76s, which have a cruising speed of between 750 and 800 kilometers per hour. So assuming that they go at an average speed of about 775 kilometers per hour, that makes for a flight time of about 6 hours, 56 minutes and 26 seconds from Vostok Station back to Punta Arenas, which I'll round up to 8 hours to account for formalities, unforeseen circumstances and such. Then of course, from Punta Arenas back to Danville is yet another 1 day 3 hours. So, our final calculation for this is 8 days 17 hours plus 6 days plus 2 days plus 1 day 3 hours plus 8 hours. So crossing the tundra all in all would take about 18 days and 4 hours. Next, building a roller coaster. Unlike the previous one, this one was pretty easy. Since Phineas and Ferb's roller coaster in the episode proper was pretty damn long, we'll just take the amount of time it took to build one of the world's longest coasters. I initially wanted to use the absolute longest, which is Steel Dragon 2000 at Nagashima Spa Land, Kuwana, Japan, but I couldn't find any data on how much time it actually took to build. So I instead settled for the second longest coaster in the world, which is the Ultimate at Lightwater Valley in Ripon, UK, which took 18 months to construct, according to Lightwater Valley's official website. So we'll take that time for this activity. Skiing down a mountain of beans. This was a fun one to work out, and the one which I wasted the most time researching. Now, our starting point is, how long would it take to ski down a regular mountain? Well, a skier named Andrzej Bargiel did once manage to ski down K2 in about 7 hours, so I decided that I'd take his attempt as the time needed to ski down the mountain itself. Now, I also tried to calculate how much time it would actually take to create a mountain of beans, and even got so far as a rudimentary theorem, but I ran into two major problems. Problem number one, I am neither a mathematician nor a kidney bean physicist, and as such have no idea how to calculate the angle of repose of the accumulated beans, or how much volume would be lost to the beans crushing themselves under the weight of each other. Two, more importantly, my theorem depends on knowing the total volume of K2, which is not exactly calculable using the information that is available freely online. So I kind of abandoned that idea, and instead assumed that the mountain of beans was already there. If anyone wants to have a crack at redoing my theorem in the comments, then feel free. But for now, let's just take the length of Bargiel's ski trip down K2, i.e. 7 hours, as the time for skiing down a pre-created mountain of beans. Next are two more incalculable ones, so let's skip straight to racing chariots. Now my research did turn up a few chariot racing experiences, but not any information on how long such an experience would take, so I turned to the show itself for this one, and by Tom's calculation, in the episode in which this took place, Phineas and Ferb's race took about 4 minutes and 4 seconds. After that, there's another incalculable one, so we'll skip to the next two. Constructing a portal to Mars and building a time machine. Now, while we don't have the technology to build either of these things yet, we can estimate how long it would take to build both of these things based on how much time it would take to build something of similar scientific complexity. Like, for instance, the Large Hadron Collider, which according to CERN, took about 24 years, 5 months, 20 days from initial conception to first switch on. So we'll take that amount of time for both constructing a portal to Mars and building a time machine. Next, stretching a rubber tree. Now, of course, this isn't possible in real life since rubber trees aren't stretchy, but we can, once again, use the intro itself to work this out. Now, I timed it in my video editing software, and by my calculation, from where we first saw them, it took about 92 sixtieths of a second, or ticks, as I'm going to call them, to stretch the tree to its full elastic potential. and in that time the tip of Phineas's nose travelled about 225 pixels. That means that from its starting point at the trunk of the tree, Phineas's nose travelled a grand total of 530 pixels. Now we have to work out exactly how long it takes to travel 530 pixels. If we multiply the time it took Phineas to travel that distance and the distance he actually travelled by 3, we can conclude that it takes 276 ticks to travel 675 pixels. 530 is 78.5185185 recurring percent of 675, and 78.5185185 recurring percent of 276 is 216.71111 recurring. Taking that as the number of ticks it takes to travel 530 pixels, converting that value back into seconds gives us, to the nearest second, about 3.6 seconds. Therefore, it takes about 3.6 seconds to stretch a rubber tree. We're in the home stretch, ladies and gentlemen, etc. Just one more thing to calculate, wailing away on guitars. Now, it's shown a few times that Phineas and Ferb already know how to play guitar, so the answer to this one is pretty simple. Just take the complete length of the extended version of the Phineas and Ferb theme song, which is 3 minutes and 1 second. Now that we've done all our calculations, which are on your screen right now, let's add them all together for our total time. To do almost everything in the Phineas and Ferb intro, in no small part thanks to painting a continent, would take 233 years, 10 months, 15 days, 7 hours, 9 minutes, 14.6 seconds. That is enough time to fill over 821.36 104-day summer vacations and 2.96 entire American lifetimes, according to the CDC. So suffice it to say, Phineas and Ferb need to reel in their expectations. But not everything is struck off, because in just 23 days, 10 hours, 53 minutes and 5 seconds total time, you could still fight a mummy, climb up the Eiffel Tower, discover something that doesn't exist, give a monkey a shower, drive your sister insane, cross the tundra, ski down a mountain of beans, race chariots, stretch a rubber tree, and wail away on guitars. At least if you're Phineas and Ferb, and also happen to be constrained by realistic time rules. And that really is that. That is how long it'd take to do almost everything in the Phineas and Ferb intro. Special thanks to the people currently on screen for helping me with my research, and thank you all very much for watching. If you've any further questions, ideas, or suggestions on how to make this more scientific, especially if it involves making my Bean Mountain theorem workable, do drop them in the comments, and be sure to like, share, and subscribe, and ding the little bell, as I said in the intro. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you all next time. Ta-ta!